Well, welcome everybody, and thanks to Strenik, who's going to hopefully moderate some of the chat through an audio stream, so hopefully we'll be able to hear him as well. So today I'm going to unclamp this little beast that I put together yesterday. You probably hear me over on the laptop, which I've also got organized, so I'll try and turn the volume down on that. Okay, so I'm going to leave this for about 3 hours. I've left it more like 13 or more. So hopefully it's set up. Who have we got with us today? Oh, not many. It's a Sunday morning just about, so I guess a lot of you are still in bed. Just us two. Right, well, it's holding together. So that's a good start. I'll clear off my glue mat. Firstly, I was going to try and see whether any of those dowels do knock out. I think I've probably got glue in all the holes, so they probably won't. I'll pop it over a dog hole, give it a little tap. Oh, there's a strike of luck. Let's see whether I can now pull it out.
So was that the intention, to be able to knock the dowels out?
Well, that's kind of trying to save some dowels for another time. See, that's not going to come out. Or that one.
So in that case, what was the reason for putting the dowels through?
The reason for putting them in is to align all these three laminations. Sorry? Because I've got these three, because of the three laminations, the dowel pins align them together when I'm gluing up. And when you're gluing things together, the glue's kind of like a lubricant, and things want to slide all over the place. So it's handy to have something that stops things moving. Ah, so a couple more people have joined. If you want to use the chat box to ask any questions or just say hello and who you are, that would be great. Now these last two dowels, I'll cut those off with a flush saw. Just really to get them out the way.
So look, you should plug those holes left by the dowels with purple heart.
Well, I could, yeah. But they're actually going to be cut away. They're not part of the finished design.
Right.
So I purposefully put the dowels in areas that weren't going to be the finished plane. They're waste areas. So you can see a very tiny mouth there. So we'll try and keep that as small as possible during the whole process, and then widen it if we need to once the iron's installed. I'll just grab the iron. And check that it'll go down a little slot, which it does. And once we've opened up the throat hole in here, we should then be able to rotate the end of the iron, which is like a spade. It obviously goes in that way round, and once it's into the throat, which you better turn it the correct way up and put the wedge in. So now I'm just going to clean up all the edges, get the glue off, and then I'll mark up for the shaping. I've set my plane for a very fine cut. I really don't want to remove anything other than the glue and something about the width of a cigarette paper. So that's all I've taken out. If you note how easy it is to plane, that's because I've always got a sharp blade in. You don't need to run at it. So we're cleaned up now. I'll grab the template. So this was a template that I printed off actual size. If you ever need to print something off the exact size, then Matthias, who's quite well known on YouTube, created a program years and years ago called Big Print, which is what I use. Works really well. So make sure I get this the right way up. So the mouth of the plane, sole of the plane, same as with the template. And now I'll just prick around the outline and then sketch it around with a pencil. What I could do is glue this on and cut to this, but I'm not too worried about that. So I'll just use an awl. I've got roughly a center point for where I can drill out most of the throat, and then I'll just mark in with the awl what I think are center points for some of the major curves in the transitions, because I'll drill those out as well. And I'll just go a little bit wider than the template size with my pricking out. This is really aesthetics rather than anything else. And when I did this for putting the dowel locations in, it was quite difficult to see some of these in the beach. So that'd be interesting, trying to sketch to the line. So I don't want to bore you with just going on and doing all of this. Let's mark up that one end.
Is there no Blue Peter moment here?
There is no Blue Peter moment. I don't need this plane, so the idea of making perhaps six to do it Blue Peter style was maybe a bit crazy, although I could have given them away, I suppose. I will grab some glasses. One of the problems with getting old is you can't see as well. So just following around those pin pricks. The other way of doing it is to use carbon paper or to lay some graphite down on the back of the template and then draw around it again. In fact, I might
definitely my preferred method.
Is it? Let's try that one, shall we? Except I can't see it through this paper, it's too thick. So I don't know where I'm putting the graphite.
Carbon paper.
Oh, carbon paper, yeah. I've probably got some somewhere, but not to hand.
I recently discovered about three boxes of it at home. So they live in the workshop now.
It's only, as I say, this is the aesthetic side of the plane, so it's not not critical. So with that on the back of this paper, if I just draw around, hopefully we'll be able to see something. I did make it difficult by using curved lines virtually everywhere. I could have done it all with straight lines. Well, I can barely see it, but you get the idea. So have we had no questions yet?
None at all.
My word, it must be Sunday morning problem. Nobody's really woken up yet. Well, maybe I should continue on and drill a hole. What do you think?
Yeah, keep going, I guess.
Okie doke.
We've just had a comment. This is pretty interesting. Please keep posting these videos.
Oh, jolly good. Thank you very much. I shall do certainly for this plane and see what the feedback is at the end of this little series. There's certainly something different for me to do. Right, a drill. Now, because I've poked those holes here with an awl, it would be most helpful to use a brad point bit, because that will align in the holes.
Shouldn't you be using a bit and brace?
Sorry?
So shouldn't you be using a bit and brace?
Well, I can do. It's been unplugged so far. Go on, I'll break out now. I'll probably break out a twister. Little egg beater drill. It's only a small hole I'm doing at the moment. And I wish I could remember what size that radius was. 6, I think. So yeah, we'll do this unplugged, shall we? Why not? I don't worry so much when I'm making tools for the workshop about being totally unplugged. For furniture, I do like to be unplugged if I can. I really want something backing that up to save any blowout. Do they not? I think this goes to about, well, clearly a quarter of an inch. This is a 6mm I've got in there. A little bit more, maybe. This is quite a modern one. Well, when I say quite modern, I mean it's probably younger than me. It doesn't say an awful lot. I don't want to drill my bench. So I think I'm close to. I will have to break the brace out to do the throat. That's somewhat larger. Hooray, I didn't go through. Now the throat I marked out. I wish it was a little bit clearer. Oh, that's there. These need a bit of sharpening. I might struggle here because my hole is, if you can see, it's right in a dowel that I cut off. So I don't think the screw's gonna pull that in. But we'll give it a go. That's about the right size.
You should be fine.
You reckon?
Otherwise you will need a Forstner bit.
Yeah. I don't have a chuck in any of my braces that will take a Forstner bit. So I'll be on the drill press.
Well, you can actually get Forstner bits that fit in a brace.
I don't have any. If any manufacturers want to send me one, hooray!
Sean was showing off his on last Thursday.
All right. Well, I've remembered since I spoke about trying to do it all unplugged, the dowel holes I actually did on the drill press, so I've failed already. I've failed. Although, I suppose because I'm cutting all those areas away, the finished item will be completely unplugged.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
Yeah. Just
well, there's that, I suppose.
Too late.
It's not pulling very well.
It still looks like it's cutting, though.
Barely, and I've got all my weight on it. Should get a ratchet one, I think. Turn the ratchet on. Well, you could guide me here. To the left or the right?
You're fine now. You were slightly off, but you straightened up now.
Oh, it's barely cutting. That's a shame. And if it does, it finds another bit of beach so it can keep pulling. Well, it's making a bit of progress.
Another question asking if you're going to make the blade as well.
Yeah, somebody asked that in the last...
It's a different person asking this time, and... He says that you can't find any books or resources for blade making, especially for moulding plates.
They can't find any?
No. I'm just looking up a resource. I think Jim Hendricks has got some great resources.
I didn't check. Can anyone who's watching this, just tell me whether you can hear Shrenik.
I'm pretty sure I can hear myself.
Oh, that's good.
Ezra says, "Hey Mitch, what's up?"
What's up is, I'm really struggling to bore this hole with the lead screw going through a dowel.
Move to the to your right. Mitch?
Yeah.
Tilt to your right.
That's my right.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. You were slightly off. Yeah, you're off. You're good now.
That's my right over there. Is that right?
Yeah, I know. Then, yes, you just needed to move over slightly.
Sorry, I confused myself. I did learn left and right when I was very young. Sometimes I forget. Well, let's see if I got through. That really is, I could be here for hours doing that. May not be able to see, but the lead screw is just torn everything out. The only way it's cutting is with... It's with my weight on that is the only thing that's made it cut, and I'm really struggling. So I think we're going to drill press with that.
Well, we tried.
We did try. No, I won't have a forceful bit that's the same size in this shot. No, that's too big. Can you see the drill press?
Yes, we can.
Super. I'll turn you around a little bit. There's not much to teach you about a drill press, except mine's very noisy. One good tip, which you should learn as soon as you can, if you've got a piece on there you're drilling, either clamp it to the base or have it rotate so it's against the column of the drill. That way it won't spin around if you let go of it. So, push the dowel out, so the centre hole I was hoping to find on the other side has disappeared. So now we have a hole. We've got two holes. This hole is part of the shaping for this front corner on the finger push. That's part of the throat. And I've got to cut out this area here. So I can start to cut some of that with the... Well, let's go unplugged again, shall we? I'll take off the rack my bow saw that I made. Clear some of this rubbish out of the way. Oh yeah, you asked me the question about the iron. I hope you're still there. My intention was to use the blade I already have, which is a Clifton blade. Clifton's great company. Do lovely blades, and that's one that I've got. But somebody else asked about it yesterday, and so I thought perhaps I would also make one to show people how they can do that. So, this is a very coarse blade, so I'll leave a fair bit to clean that afterwards. You can see the original shape. We're gradually getting towards that. If I mark in this area here, I can saw that out as well. That's where it didn't transfer very well with my graphite method, which is probably because I didn't put graphite in the area where the line was. So yeah, back to the blade. I shall probably take a off-the-shelf Stanley hand plane blade, or should I say one of the old ones, and fashion that into a blade for this. I think it's wide enough. You can rip them into two pieces down where the central hole is, and certainly both sides are wide enough to produce one of these blades.
Mitch, have you seen the method that Bill Carter uses to cut the blade down?
No, I haven't. Tell me.
He scores one side and then he saws with a hacksaw on the other side and then he snaps the blade.
Oh, okay.
Well, he actually clamps one side in a vise and smashes it with a hammer and it snaps.
That sounds reasonable.
Yeah. But I'm not sure if he does that with the Sheffield laminated steel blades or the old Stanley blades, which were not laminated, they were just solid, weren't they?
I'm not too up on the metallurgy of blades, if I'm honest with you. I have been. I've read up about it, but I just don't remember. So I'll take one of those blades, cut it down, and then fashion something this sort of shape. It's got to be close to this because the throat size I've designed can't take a larger spade on the end there. I think perhaps getting a nice consistent shaft on there, that narrow, is going to be interesting, and it certainly won't be as thick as this is certainly 3 mil. Yeah, this is 3 mil thick. The other's about 2.5. But yeah, I will be demonstrating how you can make your own blade. One of the problems, of course, with making your own blade is it's a lot of work. If you use power tools, then you've got a good chance of taking the hardness out of the steel, and then you've got to then use heat treat. To harden them again. Can you hear any ticking in the background?
Yes.
If you hear a bell suddenly, I'm cooking the Sunday roast today. Sunday roast, so I've got everything in the oven. Too coarse to be using on something this small and thin.
I did think you would have used a coping saw instead.
Yeah, it's probably somewhere in between. Coping saw's very thin. Sorry, for very more finer work than this. But I'm close to the line. If I get my rasps out, coarse rasp, I'll soon get down to that. And I think I've probably got, looking at my very cute little timer, got a couple of minutes left before I have to dash. So I'll start with the rasp, give you an idea of what I'm doing. And then in the next live stream, I should hopefully have completed most of the shaping. A very coarse Nicholson rasp. Disadvantages, you get a lot of tear out on the backside, but this blank I know is, if we look against the blade, it's certainly a couple of mil wider than it needs to be, so a little bit of tear out should be taken away when we thickness it. Before, they're super for this sort of job. Use them at the angle if you're doing something almost flat. Designed it myself, but bear in mind that I've seen a lot of shoulder planes over the years, and I know that to a certain degree some things work, some things don't. So obviously the idea of how far back to put the mouth, you know, looking at about a third of the way back, seems to be quite useful, quite workable. The shapes have very much changed from the what can be quite blocky and uncomfortable for the hand resting on top. So I've tried to carry this right over the back so the wedge and the iron go beneath there, So you never end up in a situation where the wedge or the iron is going to be digging into your wrist or into your hand. The slightly higher angle shoulder planes, more traditional ones, the iron and wedge come out the top and you'd hold it behind it like so. But I fancied trying something that was really low angle. So it's a bit of trial and error. I mean, maybe when it's finished it won't work very well. But what's it taken? A little bit of time, very small amount of material. And so I can always go and change this, put the iron in something different. So I shall continue with the shaping. Probably finish most of the shaping off. Maybe leave the throat so I can show what I'm doing with that in the next live stream. Otherwise it will be fitting of the iron and making a wedge. So any questions before I disappear? Any questions at all before I disappear and toss the roast potatoes? Nope.
None that have come up.
Okay, super. Well, thanks everyone for joining us. Thank you, Shrenik, for checking on the chat for me. And I'll see you next time. Cheerio.